the guest of the occasion, Professor D.N. Reddy Garu, Professor R. Ramaswamy Garu, Dr. Khaja M. Shahid Sahab, Professor K.R. Iqbal Ahmed Sahab, Dr. Saneem Fatima, please take the seat on the dais. Once again, on behalf of Maulana Azad National Urdu University, on behalf of School of Commerce and Business Management, Department of Business Management, I welcome you all, sir. So, मैं आप सबका इस इजलास में खैर मकदम करता हूं और रिवायत के मुताबिक हम इस इजलास का इजलास की शुरुआत कलाम पाक की तिलावत से मेरे डॉक्टर खाजा सफीउद्दीन असिस्टेंट प्रोफेसर डिपार्टमेंट ऑफ बिजनेस मैनेजमेंट विल नाउ रिसाइट सम फेजेस ऑफ कुरान बिफोर वी स्टार्ट द नॉर्मल सेशन खाजा सफीउद्दीन
Assalamu alaikum and good morning. A'udhu billahi minash shaitanir rajim. Bismillahir rahmanir rahim. Alhamdulillahi rabbil alameen. Ar-Rahmanir rahim. Maliki yawmiddin. Iyyaka na'budu wa iyyaka nasta'in. Ihdina siratal Translation of the above verses in English. All praise for Allah, the Lord of creation, the compassionate and the merciful, King of the judgment day. To you alone we worship and to you alone we pray for help. Guide us to the straight path. اس تلاوت کی گئی آیت کا اردو میں ترجمہ سماعت فرمائیں تمام تعریف اسی اللہ کے لیے ہے جو تمام عالموں کا پالنے والا ہے جو رحمان بھی ہے رحیم بھی ہے جزا و سزا کے دن کا مالک ہے ہم تیری ہی عبادت کرتے ہیں تجھی سے استعانت طلب کرتے ہیں اے ہمارے پروردگار ہم کو سیدھے راستے پر چلا ان لوگوں کا راستہ جن پر تُو نے انعام فرمایا نہ کہ ان کا راستہ جن پر تیرا غضب نازل ہوا اور جو گمراہ ہوئے آمین تھینک یو
آئی ریکویسٹ دی آرگنائزنگ سیکرٹری آف دا سیمینار ڈاکٹر سنیم فاطمہ ٹو فارملی ویلکم دا گیسٹ آف دا اوکیشن ڈاکٹر سنیم فاطمہ
ریسپیکٹڈ چیف گیسٹ ڈاکٹر ڈی این ریڈی چیئرمین آر اے سی ڈی آر ٹی او منسٹری آف ڈیفینس ممبر یو جی سی فارمر وائس چانسلر آف جے این ٹی یو حیدرآباد Professor R. Ramaswamy, Honorable Vice-Chancellor, University of Hyderabad, Dr. Khaja M. Shahid, Honorable Pro-Vice-Chancellor, Maulana Azad National Urdu University, Professor K.R. Iqbal Ahmed, Director, Directorate of Distance Education and In-Charge Dean, School of Commerce and Business Management, MANUU, Professor Najma Akhtar, Head, Department of Training, Capacity Building in Education, NEOPA, Heads of the Departments, Members of Teaching and Non-Teaching Fraternity, Participants and Students, a very good morning to all of you. At the outset, I extend a warm welcome to this two-day national seminar on management of higher education, perspectives, challenges, and strategies organized by the Department of Management and Commerce. To start with, I request our Honorable Pro-Vice-Chancellor, Dr. Khwaja M. Shahid, to welcome our chief guest, Dr. D.N. Reddy with the bouquet. May I now request Dr. Khwaja M. Shahid, Honorable Pro-Vice-Chancellor, to also welcome Professor R. Ramaswamy, Honorable Vice-Chancellor, Hyderabad Central University. Dean. I request our Dean, Professor K.R. Iqbal Ahmed Sahab, to welcome Dr. Khwaja M. Shahid, Honorable Pro-Vice-Chancellor. Thank you, sir. To start with, I thank Professor Mohammad Mia Sahab, Honorable Vice Chancellor Manu, for entrusting me the responsibility to organize this seminar. I'm grateful to Dr. Khwaja M. Shahid, Honorable Pro Vice Chancellor, for his continuous guidance and support. I'm also thankful to our Dean, Professor K.R. Iqbal Ahmed Sahab, for his involvement in organizing this seminar, and equally thankful to all my students and colleagues in this endeavor. We have had an overwhelming response to this seminar with participants from across the country, contributing research papers, articles covering all the 10 sub-themes of the seminar. As many as 100 papers have been received, out of which 50 have been selected after double-blind peer review. The delegates shall present their viewpoints in 6 technical sessions scheduled in these 2 days. We intend to bring out the proceedings of the seminar in the form of a book with ISBN number. In education, the focus today is on promotion of higher education, with the government striving its best to improve the gross enrollment ratio in higher education to 30% by the year 2020 from the current 19%. We know that today there are about 700 universities and more than 35 colleges in India. During the 12th five-year plan, it has been proposed to increase the student enrollment capacity to 10 million students, which includes 1 million students in open and distance learning. The base for these enrollments in higher education is the massive expansion of schooling and secondary education in the last decade, coupled with the aspirations of the youth. The roadmap for the development of higher education in India is backed up by the support from the government in the 12th plan, which focuses on quality in higher education. Huge investments are required to be mobilized from the government grants, private investments, and better utilization of these investments, enhancing employability of students passing out, encouraging private participation in higher education, emphasis on research culture and faculty-related issues, apart from several other issues needed to improve quality and promote excellence in higher education. Along with the abundant opportunities, there are various challenges in higher education in India. Talking about the challenges, the major areas can be classified as expansion, equity, and excellence. Expansion focuses at improving the gross enrollment ratio, which is a huge task. Equity looks at balancing the wide disparity in terms of rural-urban, gender, community imbalances in pursuit of providing education to all. Excellence refers to the problems in the areas of research, faculty shortage, accreditation of institutions, and low citation impact, etc. To emphasize one such point, we can look at the student-teacher ratio, which is just 24:1 in India compared to the other developed countries, which is very less compared to the other developed countries like USA, UK, etc. Effective management of higher education leads to improving quality education, which is the key to inclusive growth and empowerment of a large section of the society. Here, the mention of key objectives of RUSA, that is Rashtriya Uchchatar Shiksha Abhiyan, needs to be taken into account, which are to improve access, equity and quality in higher education to plan development of higher education at the state level. This development can be achieved by creating new academic institutions while expanding the existing ones. These institutions need to become self-reliant in terms of quality education, should be professionally managed and be inclined towards research and development, and provide students with satisfaction that is relevant to them and as well as to the nation as a whole. With this, I wish that at the end of these 2 days, this seminar will have had discussions and deliberations to the issues which are relevant to the issues of management of higher education in India. Thank you for patience.
Ye thi Dr. Sanim Fatima. Dr. Sanim Fatima, she is head of the department business management. She joined the department in 2006, and she is a HRM faculty here. Now, I request our Dean, Professor K.R. Iqbal Ahmed Sahab, to introduce the guest. Before he comes here, he is a man who is always behind the department. Since 2005, in the capacity of in charge registrar, pro vice chancellor, in charge vice chancellor, and many more responsibilities he had, but he has always been with the Department of Business Management. From 11 students, now the department is 124 students, and in his leadership we have started MCOM course also. Now the first batch has already gone and the second batch is in the fourth semester. So department always remember the former vice chancellor Professor A.M. Pathan Sahab in his dynamic leadership the department has started, and the present vice chancellor is also giving a lot of helping hand to the department for its development. Now I request our Dean Professor K.R. Iqbal Ahmed Sahab to introduce the guest.
All praise and glory is to the Lord Almighty, the Creator. Very distinguished academician and highly reputed administrator, former Vice Chancellor of JNTU, member of UGC, Chairman Recruiting Committee of DRDO, a very renowned engineer of the country, the great son of the soil, Professor D. Narasimha Reddy Garu, the Honorable Vice Chancellor, world-renowned scientist, Professor Ramakrishna Ramaswamiji, Honorable Vice Chancellor of Dr. Khaja E.M. Shahid Saab, Honorable Pro Vice Chancellor of our university, respected Najma Akhtar Madam, my colleagues and very participants and dear students. We are all aware that education, I am reminded of Swami Vivekananda, education is the manifestation of perfection already in man. Education has been shaping the destinies of nations and civilizations. Today, MANUU, which is a central university, which is a dual mode university, which is the only university in the country which is offering education, particularly higher education, in Urdu medium, has taken it as a challenge to offer professional, vocational, and job-oriented courses in Urdu medium. And the, along with our colleges of teacher education, along with our ITIs, polytechnics, BTech and MTech programs, Unani, paramedical courses, this university is trying its best to showcase the programs and relate jobs with education. The Department of Commerce and Management and Commerce, which was established in the year 2004, has been actively engaged in academic pursuits from its since its beginning, and a number of conferences, programs, seminars have been conducted by this department, and fortunately today we have one such academic endeavor in the form of this seminar with the theme. The theme is the management of higher education, perspectives, challenges, and strategies. This topic was suggested by none other than our Honorable Vice Chancellor, which was actively supported by our Pro Vice Chancellor. Hats off to them for thanks to them for asking the Department of Commerce and Management to take up this initiative. The present theme, according to me, is highly current, comprehensive, and concise for such of those knowledge workers who care for knowledge and who care for higher education. Friends, we know that management of higher education in the context of India is not that easy task at all. And learned scholars, vice chancellors, and administrators, they know much better than us that it is a bigger challenge, and it has issues, concerns for the academicians, policy planners, and the institutions. Today in India, we have more than 700 universities, 35,671 colleges, and national, deemed, private, otherwise institutions, along with national institutions of national importance like IIMs, IITs, and all that, but we are not able to come to the expectations of within 200 of the world-rated universities. That is the sad commentary, and people, intellectuals always talk about that, and Government of India, with its experience of Sarva Shiksha Abhiyan, Madhyamik Shiksha Abhiyan, and recently the RUSA, Rashtriya Uchchatar Shikshan Abhiyan, is thinking very seriously to promote higher education. And in this context, 12th plan and 11th and 12th plan have been plans of inclusion, inclusive growth, and
so the chief guest have to go, sir.
Yes, sir. Yes. Chief guest, without, no. Yeah, now chief guest,
I
No, sir. First of all, and on this occasion, we have bothered two big people to come here. One is Ramakrishna Ramaswamy, a very renowned scientist, who has earned his PhD from Princeton University in 1978. And he had his education in Laila College, Madras. And earlier, he was in JNTU, Tata Institute of Fundamental Research, Mumbai. And since 2011, he is the Honorable Vice Chancellor of Hyderabad, University of Hyderabad. Sir, we are proud of your achievements. We are proud of your academic achievements. And we are really fortunate to have accepted at such a short notice that speaks of your concern to higher education. I thank you and welcome you to deliver your address. And thereafter, I also take this opportunity to introduce Professor D.N. Reddy Saab. He is a very, very big academician of the country, renowned scientist, member of UGC, and awards and rewards have been showered on him like anything. We welcome you, sir. And after Professor Ramakrishna Ramaswamy gives his views, you would be the next speaker. And we don't want to take much of your time. We would like to release you as early possible. Thank you. Now, Professor Ramaswamy.
This was our dean. This was our dean, Professor K.R. Iqbal Ahmed Saab. Now we are releasing the souvenir of the. I request our department colleagues to come. The dais. Souvenir of the conference. Vice Chancellor Hyderabad Central University, Professor R. Ramaswamy Garu, to address the occasion. Sir has to move from here on some occasions.
Let me start by apologizing for this very abbreviated ceremony of inauguration of this very important conference. It's a pleasure to be here at MANUU, and I should actually acknowledge this is the first time I have come to, to come on this side of MANUU. I usually come and attend a variety of meetings, so thank you very much, Khaja Sahab, for inviting me. It's a pleasure to actually share the dais with Professor Reddy, and I'm looking forward to hearing him. So I will not say very much except to underscore the importance of a conference like this. And it goes, I think, a little beyond the numbers. Saneem Fatima ji and others have commented that we have 700 universities and we have 35,000 colleges and what have you. But I think the challenges of higher education in India are more than that. And I would like to recall the great man after whom your university is named. Maulana Azad, at some point, he wrote a very important piece on education in India. And he pointed out to one very important thing, which we still have not done. He said that there was an urgent need to Indianize higher education. This Indianization of higher education means different things to different people. But since the time that Maulana Azad Saab said those words, I forget precisely when it was, but it may have been in late 1960s. I'm still trying to track down the precise reference to when he said it. We've not worried about it. Sometimes people write textbooks, some Indians write textbooks, but that's not Indianizing the education. And you know, and as time has gone on and our challenges have grown, we have not addressed this very important fact. All of us in this room, we think in one language and speak in another. If I should start asking you to do a small calculation, you will count in ek, do, teen, char, or, you know, or whichever language one thinks in. I mean, this is just a trivial example of where our thought processes, our transactional processes, they occur in different languages in different ways. And one way people say this is that A for apple is, neither is A an Indian thing, nor is apple an Indian thing, and yet we all learn A for apple. More importantly, we have to worry about educating India. We are not just educating some abstract bunch of people. We are worrying about educating our people. Our people who live in our country, who think the same way that they do, and for whom G for Gonkura is more relevant than, you know, than A for apple or what have you. You know, we've got to think a little about that. And at the heart of it is what I believe Maulana Azadji himself recognized, that just taking education ready-made from some other platform is not going to be enough. I mean, there's much more to say about these things. I will not say it because I'm sure you all who are worrying about the management of education can say it much better. Let me just conclude now by wishing the conference very well. But more than wishing the conference very well, I hope that I also wish the future of Indian higher education very well. Thank you.
Thank you very much, sir. And now we thank the guest, Professor Ramaswamy Garu, with a memento. I request our dean to present a memento to the Professor Ramaswamy. And also the Pro Vice Chancellor to Professor Ramaswamy. So thank you very much, sir. Now, Narasimha Reddy Garu, famous by his name, Professor D.N. Reddy, is the former Vice Chancellor of JNTU. I request Professor D.N. Reddy Garu to address the occasion.
Ramakrishna Ramaswamy Garu, Vice Chancellor of, he is a very distinguished scientist and also Vice Chancellor of Hyderabad Central University. My good friend, Professor Khwaja Shahid Saab, Pro Vice Chancellor of Maulana Azad National Open University, National University at Hyderabad. Dr. Iqbal Ahmed Saab, Dean of the Faculty. Dr. Saneem Fatima is the Organizing Secretary of this particular seminar. And distinguished faculty members and participants, young student friends, ladies and gentlemen. At the very outset, I would like to congratulate the university, particularly Faculty of Commerce and Business Management, to organize this very important national seminar on higher education challenges. I hope, in fact, organizers already given an introduction to the entire seminar, and Professor Ramaswamy has shared his views on particularly in higher education, in what direction we need to move. And in fact, I only 10 minutes, I apologize because I have to another program, because the organizers requested me only 3-4 days back. They said if you come for 30 minutes, okay. I sincerely apologize that I have to leave at 10:30. So I'd like to, copies may be made available to your presentation, but I briefly touch upon the presentation, salient points of what are the challenges faced in higher education in our country. Can I have a first slide? Yeah, particularly the impact of globalization on higher education, it affects in the country higher education as well, because we have many foreign universities are coming in, and it's because of globalization, opportunities given to our Indian students also to pursue higher education in various countries across. And the major difference it makes in the globalization is that the flexibility of courses in overseas universities, whereas flexibility is not built in Indian system. We need to go further ahead because ours is British legacy. We have structured courses and 2-year, 4-year, 3-year structured courses, and flexibility is not much brought in except few universities. I think we need to do that. and quality and relevance. Our Government of India policy is access, inclusion, and quality and relevance. That is the policy of Government of India for higher education. So we need to have, apart from access to education to all the needy, we have 55 million youngsters in this country. Only 15% are coming to higher education. We need to promote 30%. World average is 23%. And we are lagging behind world average. So access is important, but same time, instead of mushrooming the institution, we also need to have a quality. And whatever education imparted should be relevant to society at large. That is more important. That's why quality and relevance. Teaching learning process will drive improving the quality. Because teaching methodology, age-old practice of blackboard chalk piece, that's the best method even today. But because you have to use the technology for imbibing understanding capacity among student community. ICT greatly help, particularly teaching faculty, to maybe make the students learn faster and also understand better. That is in information communication technology we have to use in teaching learning process. So we are using today PPT. PPT labs absorption capacity is slightly increased compared to extempore speaking. Yeah, education is luxury for elite and a necessity for all. It's necessary for everyone in this country. Why education? What for education? Education gives us competence. Education gives us confidence. Education gives us creativity. That's why we're all eager to get educated. That's the reason. So the uneducated person, he works hard and sleep without any worry. Educated persons worry a lot. We want to do so many things in life. So the new student, today a student is not necessarily should come to classroom. Digitally mobile. He comes to classroom, he can sit in library, cafeteria, or lawns. He can access to the teaching learning processes, teaching learning methodology. Content he can access. That's why called digitally mobile. That is possible because of internet. A new world order is human capital. Today, India, every country in the world looking at India and China because we have a large human capital base. A large number of youngsters are there, who are English speaking and working hard, sincerity. They can, any cultures, any situation, they can able to adapt. That's why they're looking at Indian students and Chinese students, particularly. Human capital is the new world order. A new technology is internet tools. Internet technology gave an impetus for all of us to access the information everywhere. Earlier, when I was a student, there was no calculator, there was no computer, and no library resources. Today, library resources are available at doorstep. Student can access. So the student doesn't depend more on the teacher nowadays. Earlier, the student would depend only on the teacher. But now, more information is available for students to pursue understanding better. So the internet tools plays a great role. Internet tools and millions of youngsters today access to the information through internet. Google gives a lot of information. Traditional institution with the difference. Now we need to have a traditional view of imparting education. We need to have an interface with the technology so that imbibe higher level of understanding. Education imperatives is concerned. We have skills and knowledge. So institutions are meant for creating knowledge, whereas industry is meant for creating prosperity. We require prosperity, we require knowledge. Universities are meant for creating knowledge. So that's why institution and industry should come together so that knowledge is there, prosperity will be there. That's the idea of interfacing with universities, with institution. Skills are utmost important. Indian students are theoretically very good, highly qualified, but as coming to practical knowledge is concerned, they are weak compared to other overseas countries. Skill base is very important. If you go to forest countries like Singapore, Malaysia, Taiwan, Korea, Japan, they are not much educated, but skill base is very good. So today you are buying Samsung, electronics, television, or mobile phones, all coming from forest countries. Why India is such a large human resource base with expert? Why you are not able to make electronics and digital mobile phones? Why? Because our skill base is not there. Indian skill base is only 15% to 20%, whereas skill base in Singapore, Malaysia, Japan is 85%. Skill gap is there. That's why education employment gap we need to bridge. That's a more important. And the skills and knowledge goes a long way, particularly achieving. I talked about education employment gap is there. And the UNESCO report or other NASSCOM report, they all mentioned that only 23% of Indian students are employable. That is, of course, IT and IT enabled. But large extent, majority are not able to get job because readily they are not able to employ by the organization because they're looking for some skills, whether it join a tourism industry, whether in a hospitality industry, whether you join in management or any corporate sector. They want day one, you should be able to attend to the needs of the organization, which students fail to do that. That's why skill could be in many ways. Technical skills, analytical skills, communication skills, and personality. Personality is most important. Communication skills are important. Communication means not necessarily you should speak English, either Urdu or Telugu or any language. Whatever you speak, other person should understand. That's what communication. So that is, we should be able to convey better. So the skills are most important, and soft skills and analytical skills. And citizenship also, not only getting graduated and getting employment, getting married, buying house, that is one part of life, but you should also serve the society. Citizenship also important, how we are useful to the society at large. Development key behavioral skills. Behavior, attitudes and behaviors are very important. So in this world, people are looking at outcome-based education. So outcome-based means what a student is doing after graduating from university. So outcome is important. Outcome is measured in three forms. One is knowledge, second is skill, third is behavior attitude. There should be behavioral difference between an uneducated fellow and educated fellow. So that's why behavioral skills and attitudes are plays a vital role in our system. Effectively applying concepts. What you have learned concept here should be able to apply. Otherwise, there is no use. Somebody has worked hard for 4 years PhD. Ultimately, for what? You have to translate into technology or society, some drug discovery or something useful to society at large. That should be the aim. Not getting PhD personally benefited. You get promotion, you get a job. But society, how it is benefited? Because country is spending huge amount of money on a graduates. Okay, that way you have to look at it. Imbibe higher level of understanding. Understanding in the classroom important. Normally a bright student in a classroom can absorb only 25%. Not more than that. Because other thing you will learn by discussing with your colleagues or with the teachers or using technology, using access to information or while working. All this we will try to acquire knowledge. But higher level of understanding is more important. Our education system in the classroom, in the universities, we have to make the students learn. Taking attendance 10 or 15 minutes, it goes waste, isn't it? So neither he benefited nor we benefited. So discipline of one part, of course, required. But it's also interest should come among student community. You should be willing to come. We can't force all the time. So learning approach. Learning earlier, we have a teacher-centric, student-centric learning methodology. Nowadays, we have a learning-centric. That means teacher has to learn, student has to learn. Both. That's why it's a learning-centric environment. With that approach, we have to follow in the instruction methodology in the universities. Innovation is the key. Whatever learn, innovation.